Over the next few months, that little boy began to visit the clockmaker and ask him a lot of questions. Well, boy, look at this illustration. The pendulum, that swinging weight, is the timekeeping element. Every swing of the pendulum weight releases the escapement wheel to move one more segment every 60 seconds, which moves the hands of the clock face. Then he asked the critical question. Based on the boy's parents' agreement.
Yes, I guess that would be okay.
Eli Terry, at the age of 14, agreed to a 6-year apprenticeship. Mr. Burnett then sat down with the boy and told him the key tasks that he would have to learn. Then Eli spent time at the local foundry, learning to melt lead into rough molds. He also learned the far more delicate pouring of the pewter into the molds to form the dial hands of the clock. Eli's next task was to cut the teeth on the brass plate so that the teeth on one wheel could engage with the teeth from the other wheel. Then, firmly pushing the foot pedal, Terry could cut a tooth and then move the blank brass wheel to a precise location for the next tooth. All that was left was the slow and laborious filing of individual teeth to match their corresponding gear. Then the local cabinet maker created a tall clock case, installed Terry's movement, and a week later, that weird old lady on King Street bought the clock and carried it to her wagon. The clock and Terry's movement then sat in the reception hall for the next 60 years. With periodic maintenance, it told good time. But if any wheel was ever damaged, no similar wheel could ever be constructed, for there were still no interchangeable parts. That era had not arrived. I bet they could sell my new clocks. I'll have to do something about that. There, he married his childhood sweetheart in 1793. Okay, then. He was blessed that his village was surrounded by a wide variety of trees. Eli decided to use oak for the front and back plates, cherries for the wheel and gears, and other hardwoods for the pinions and pillars. For the clock plates, Eli would take the oak boards off the sawmill, split them with his froe, and then plane them to the required dimensions. For the cherry wheels, he would use the belt from the mill to power the fly cutter to cut each gear. For the pillar posts, he placed a traditional foot-powered lathe on the second floor to turn the connecting posts between the plates. In 1807, Edward and Levi Porter offered Terry significant funds to upgrade his factory if he could produce 4,000 clocks in the next 3 years. First, he enforced consistent standards to ensure grain direction and dimensions for every manufactured part. Second, he used one standard template to punch the locations of all the holes for the front and back plate. Third, he adapted every woodworking operation for water pulp. Next, he adapted his machines so he could cut more parts in every operation. Finally, before shipping, he tested the efficiency of the pendulum and the striking of the hour. Harold, we are late again. Hurry up. All these will be picked up at noon. Hey, we got 20 clocks going to Virginia. We will follow clock sales in Union City, Virginia, at the Allen Burton General Store. Burton hired John Brown and brought a peddler's wagon with three trunks of goods that he knew the customers needed. I think these will sell like hotcakes. Hello, Mr. Jones. Hello. Sometimes it was a social occasion, seeking the latest gossip from the city and maybe purchasing some cloth for the missus' new dress. It seemed the best clock sales were for clocks that had a case made by a cabinet maker and to a farmer who needed to ship his crops by the railroad. The new design captured the popular neoclassical columns and scrolls, admired by the southern farmers, bringing good taste into their humble home. Friends, this clock will strike every hour for 30 continuous hours, delighting your friends and family. The new sales made Eli Terry a rich man.
Congratulations.
He then watched his apprentices and then his sons continue the business.